today's video, let us look at the reconstruction of metabolic networks, which is actually a very challenging task, and we will review some of the basic concepts for metabolism and then how one goes about reconstruction and what are the ways of representing these networks. So, let us look at metabolic networks, which will help us better understand the concepts of stoichiometry and so on. This is a simple system of chemical reactions, right. You have A plus B giving 2C, which means the two moles of C are produced from the reaction between 1 mole of A and 1 mole of B. 1 molecule, 2 molecules of C. And then you have B plus 2C giving 2D. So, here the stoichiometric coefficients are different. This is a more realistic system. That was a toy system. This is a more realistic system. You will be able to recognize that this is glycolysis. So, it starts with 1 molecule of glucose, finally ends with 2 molecules of pyruvate with the net production of so many ATPs, right. Some ATP is used on the left hand side and some ATP is produced on the right hand side and so on, right. So, this is a real system. If you want to look at a really real system, this is what it looks like. I have shown you a picture like this before, and this is in some sense a simplified view of all the complexity that happens within the cell. And mind you, this is only one network. We have the metabolic network interlaced with the other networks we have been studying earlier today, right. So, the gene regulatory network, the signaling network, they all exist together, right. We have chosen to slice it out and just study one of these networks, but in reality they all exist together. So, how does this translate? So, if you look at a real system, this might be how a real system looks to a modeler. It is essentially a long list of alphabetized list of chemical reactions. So, it starts with some activated tRNA all the way up till gamma glutamyl putrescine and so on. So, it is essentially a long linear list of all possible reactions, but there is also other information that we may want to include in a metabolic network so that we can simulate it. So, what information needs to go into a metabolic network? So, to give you an analogy of what a metabolic network is, think of individual reactions as representing isolated roads in a city. And then you have a metabolic map that looks more like a road map. There's something that you can infer from here, you can know the individual reactions, whether there is a road between two places or not, to junctions, to immediate places. This is what will tell you a lot more information. It will tell you if it is possible to reach this metabolite from this metabolite, or maybe is it possible to reach from this part of the city to this part of the city, right. So, this is useful, but the maximum amount of information comes when you actually look at the flux distributions, or the equivalent of how much traffic flows through which road, right. This is when you get the maximum amount of information, and this is what you want to make a lot of predictions using. So, metabolic networks are normally studied trying to understand A, can I produce X from Y. More importantly, if I have a reaction, if I have this network, how much traffic is flowing towards this protein of interest, this metabolite of interest, right. So, I start here, how many branches, where all does my traffic flux get split and so on. So, this becomes very important, how do we study this. So, one important aspect of these networks is you have to first reconstruct them, right. In all of these networks, you have to reconstruct them. How do you build them from the scratch, right. So, how do you build a gene regulatory network? You essentially get some gene expression data and so on and try to reconstruct it. In a signaling network, you actually have to know the signaling proteins and so on. In metabolism, it again gets quite challenging, but the good thing is that we already know a lot about cellular biochemistry, right. So, you have the help of biochemistry textbooks, literature and so on, and pathway databases, and you can pull information from all these places and assemble this long list of reactions. It is like everybody gets taught glycolysis in a biochemistry course, right. And many such pathways exist within the cell, and you integrate all these pathways into a complex model.
Sir, signaling networks, how will we know the edge weight or from one receptor to another receptor or one ligand to receptor, how will we know the interaction?
Yeah. So, it really depends on what you want to model. The normal way to model a signaling network might just be to look at an interaction network, where you do not worry about the weights, or you may actually worry about it in great depth by using dynamic modeling, what is the binding constant for these two proteins, what is the rate of reaction between these two enzymes, this enzyme and this ligand, and so on. So it depends upon the level in which you model it. So you start with the genome. This is one of the most painstaking processes that you will have. It involves a lot of time and effort. You start with the genome. Hopefully the open reading frames have already been assigned. What are the proteins in that particular genome? Some functional annotation must have hopefully been done. And then you have the whole cell, right? All the entire proteome of the cell. And then you integrate information from literature, from biochemistry textbooks, from pathway databases, any high throughput experiments and so on. And finally build a model. This model has to have all the information about, what information should it have?
So it should have information about the stoichiometry of every reaction, the directionality of every reaction.
Right, whether the reaction goes from A to B or B to A in a given condition, and what are all the enzymes catalyzing this reaction. One or more enzymes catalyzing this reaction.
So how will we take upon the reversibility or irreversibility?
So you need to have some thermodynamic information. Otherwise, you may have to come up with some other rules of the thumb. For example, you know that reactions involving ATP may not be reversible. Reactions producing CO2 may not be reversible. Things like that. So there are these thumb rules for, there's some well-known rules to adjudge reversibility. But ideally, you need to have delta G values. So you start with the list of reactions. That's the first thing that you need, followed by the stoichiometry, whether it is A plus 2B or 2A plus B or just A plus B, giving whatever C and D on the right hand side. What is the specificity? Does your reaction admit NADH, NADP, NADPH, and so on? Is your reaction balanced? That's very important. What are the directionality or thermodynamics? And what are the gene protein reaction associations? We'll look at this again when we study detail. But you typically want to know that there is a protein gene SDHA and a gene SDHB that encodes for the protein SDHA. This forms a complex which catalyzes this reaction. It is reaction R1. So this information has to be there, because this will let you know if I remove SDHA, then this guy will go out, which finally stops this reaction happening. Y will no longer be produced, and if Y is important for the cell, the cell might die. But you do need this information. So this is called gene protein reaction, or GPR associations. This is a very important step of metabolic network reconstruction or curation. So here, as you may have guessed, the reaction directionality or thermodynamics is the hardest part. How do you get accurate information on reaction directionality and thermodynamics? It's usually not available for a lot of compounds, so it becomes very tricky. For example, if you look at the KEG database, which is one of the most popular metabolic network databases, it has no information on reaction directionality. It essentially assumes every direction is reversible. What are the challenges in reconstruction? Right. So every step of this process is fraught with difficulties, right. So if it is a new genome, how will you functionally annotate it in the first place? You are hoping that you will have enough similarities to existing genome. So that becomes a challenge. And some organisms are very difficult to culture or study in a lab, right. If you want to work with mycobacterium tuberculosis, it is pathogenic. And worse still, it has a doubling time of about little more than 24 hours. E. coli doubles in 15 minutes, peaceful to study. Right? This becomes a lot harder to study. And how do you extend in vitro or in vivo observations to, if you have an in vitro observation, how do you extend it to in vivo observations? Right?
So what you do in a beaker may not be really what happens in a real cell. How do you represent these networks? Right. I think we already looked at it briefly earlier. So we looked at substrate graphs, reaction graphs, enzyme graphs and bipartite graphs. So let us just refresh what they are, and then we will also study how you can represent these using a matrix. So what is a substrate graph? Let us say this is the reaction network. How does the substrate graph look like? We will have a node for A, a node for B, a node for C, we have already discussed this. So what is the challenge here? Misleading conclusions. You may assume that it is possible to convert B to E without the presence of A. Whereas if A is not there, you may not be able to even perform this reaction. So this is a danger. So as we, you might remember, you would be presented with a two-step glycolysis, right? Glucose, ADP, pyruvate, which is wrong. So the next step would be to represent this as a reaction or enzyme graph. So wherein you have E1, E2, E3. E1 is the enzyme that does A to C, A B to C, E2 is the enzyme that does C to D, and E3 is the enzyme that does D to E and F. You could also replace this with reactions, so it is the same thing. So this is a reaction or enzyme graph. And the more informative way to represent these is a bipartite graph. Where you have A, B, E1 or R1, C, E2, D, E3. This looks more like what you would see in a biochemistry textbook. The one important thing is that you have to understand that A and B are required for this enzyme to produce this product.
In today's video, we overviewed several concepts underlying metabolic network reconstruction, as well as how do you represent metabolic networks, and we particularly saw that bipartite graphs give you a very good reliable representation for metabolic networks. And in the next video, we will move on to a different topic. We will start off with dynamic modeling.